several announcements to make, so hang on your chair for several of them. So, I would of course like to welcome our visitors, and if you are looking for a church home, this is a church home, probably, and that's something you should consider. This is, looking around, this is a glimpse of what heaven will look like. And again, I would like to invite everyone for fellowship lunch. After the sermon, we have fellowship lunch. Everybody's welcome. And for those who donated the flowers to the front, if anyone of you would like to donate flowers to express your thanksgiving for any special occasions, birthdays, celebrations, weddings, you are most welcome. And the church budget update, the projected budget is 5,500. Please provide and give wholeheartedly and faithfully. And there is a membership transfer. This is the second reading. Sheila Harvey from Tredegar, I'm pronouncing it right. Tredegar Park, SDA Church in Jamaica, is due Armona SDA Church. Okay. There's a motion. If you are in favor of the transfer, can you raise your right hand? Okay, that's good. And those who are not, raise your hands as well. Right hand and left hand.
It's and
is that?
Today's your birthday.
Oh, it's her birthday as well. Happy birthday, Sheila. And maybe a second one. So it's final for the shirts. And more announcements to make, so we have special dates to remember. Mark your calendars. Youth Vesper for now is canceled. Wait for our future announcement. Because it's in conflict with our bonus schedule. This school has something going on. Tomorrow, the pastor spoke to me last night. Emphasizing that tomorrow, those leaders and their members, please come tomorrow. It's a potluck meeting for strategic planning. So leaders, members of different ministries, please come tomorrow at 9. The first hour will be breakfast, and the remaining hours will be the training. So I believe most of the leaders are here. Please come. Because the pastor would like to have this meeting tomorrow. And then the hospital is being trained, also things will be part of that tomorrow for all the leaders. And even for that, they would like to be trained. They're all welcome tomorrow. The pastoral staff meeting is only on February 5th at 6:30 p.m. And the church board meeting will be February 8th at 6:30 p.m. And then there's a sundown, a vesper, and bonfire, Saturday, February 10th, the next Sabbath. Oh no, next month, February 10th, 4:30 p.m. It's going to be one of the houses of the Exeter members in Visalia. And then there's a special midweek music praise and worship by Dr. Calvin Taylor. And I'm not sure where it's going to be. It's going to be 28, but I don't know where. Right here. Okay. So it's going to be in the church. So, mark your calendar. I know it's going to be very, very good program. And then, if you look at your insert here, there's another program. It's going to be on the 26th. This is what I'm referring to next Friday of this week, 6:30 at Redwood Church. And also, for the ladies who are attending the women's ministry, women's retreat, please stay and meet with Anita. You're going to have a little meeting. Very good meeting, right? After the sermon, the service today. And for those volunteers and leaders, you have to complete a mandatory online volunteer training. The link is at the back of your bulletin. And then I got to call Neil. Neil, come forward. Yeah. Okay. Sure.
You have to make some notes.
Whatever Holy Spirit is putting in your hearts to give us.
Amen.
So,
which one?
Okay, so that's the location where we is. It's in the southeast of Mexico. It's a border with Guatemala. That's one of the many streets. As you see, there's a lot of Indian people there. It's very interesting. This very rich culture, pre-Hispanic culture there. Before the Spanish people get there to Mexico, they're still maintaining their traditions and culture. As I told you, that the town is in the mountains, so it's fresh. It's like average of like 65 degrees all year round. That's the main control there. One of the streets very colorful, so that the houses is painted very colorful.
Nice place. Oh, by the way, that time is the time where there's a lot of fruit. So we're going to be enjoying a lot of fresh fruit. Spanish is a lot of dialects. We're going to get translators there. Population 185,000. I think that's the double of the temple. They work a lot with
minerals, like
beautiful stones and rocks. That's the main square. They also have an underground river, so where you can explore it and go in there and snorkel and a lot of things that you can do there. That's a beautiful, they call it the blue waterfalls. In the picture, it looks like a white is blue. Oh, that's a beautiful area too. That's the, it's in the canyon. It's, they say that it's bigger than the Grand Canyon here in Arizona, but that one with water and rivers. Well, we are a couple of miles from the one of the main cities of the main culture. The name is Palenque. Another beautiful, I think that's the entrance to the underground river. So, as I told you, so keep it in mind, since you're going to be hearing from us for more sliding pictures for the planning of this big endeavor. Thank you, guys.
So, I know how we encourage our youth to participate in missions, and most of our, well, some of our youth, I know some have been part of our missions in the past. And remember, the first week of missions or work, and those picture was shown here, is an opportunity for cultural discoveries of the mission group. So it's a reward part.
What is the date for that mission?
The tentative date so far is July, first week of July, right?
The first 10 days.
On the mission. And then, I don't have an announcement, I'll probably share with you anyways. There's another mission the hospital is offering for August. It's going to be in Malawi. It's going to be a joint venture with Loma Linda University and Madera Children's Hospital. So I don't know how far the day I'm involved in conversation. So we'll announce it as well in case it happens. And so far, that's all the announcements we have. Thank you.
Stand.
Let us pray. Gracious God, Heavenly Father, we thank you for this very moment. Thank you for the gift of the summer. And may we ask for your presence with us, Heavenly Father, and help us to have an open heart and an open mind that is ready to receive your instructions coming from your Holy Spirit. Heavenly Father, may our worship service today be acceptable in your holy name. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Amen.
Whether you and team would like to come across the street and see whether any of them fit in. If so, well, we will make a special price. Sure enough, 5 of the 7 or 8 suites were perfect fit without any alterations. The price, $15 each. He still wears some of those suites today. Be faithful in your giving. Do you like surprises? So does God. And you never know what he was in store for you next. Deacons, please come for me.
Thank you. Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
Oh, happy to the energy. Let's say it all over again. Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
There you go. Now, can we ask Madge?
But anyways,
there you go. It's not working. It's five more times. There you go. Now, anyways, who among you would like to travel? Who loves to travel here? Okay, I know who among you like to see beautiful places. Almost everyone. Almost everybody. Today, you're gonna see or probably talk about one of the most beautiful places. I'll just describe as one of the most beautiful places in the world. The place is called, okay, we're getting there, called Dubai. You know what Dubai, you know where Dubai is? Dubai is one of the seven emirates or seven cities of the United Arab Emirates, Persian Gulf. And the city is famous for beautiful and ultra-modern buildings. And Las Vegas shopping. It is the home of the largest shopping mall. It's also the home of the tallest building in the world. The building is about 160 feet story high. And Dubai is also the Palm, which is a man-made island, and only rich people and billionaires can buy properties over there. And can you imagine be able to see the place and visit the place? Who among you would like to see the place or visit the place? Somebody? Somebody would like to see Dubai? Well, I think some of our adults would like to see Dubai. But you know what? In order to get there, what do you need? Having known how expensive the country is, you need money, right? You need passport, you have to pack. But I would like to talk about another place. Another place that you don't need passport, you don't need to pack. And it's actually being built now. It's being built for all of us. Do you have any ideas what city I'm talking about? Heaven. Very good. So, by the way, before I go to the heaven, there's another building being built in Dubai. It's another, you're going to see this in 2020, they will have, it's going to be seen in their skyline. It's the first, again, in Dubai, the rotating building. It's about 80 floor. Each of the buildings is rotating. And the residents will be paying $40 million just to live in this building. And they have the opportunity or the glimpse of the side of the 360 view of the city. So it looks like this. So by 2020, you can. Now, have you changed your mind? This is what city of Dubai and probably the city's building. Okay. But, anyways, going back to the question earlier that the other building we're going to be visiting today or the other city is heaven. So, the Bible has a very good description. You know what, we don't know exactly how it's going to look like, but the creative mind of artists, they gave us an idea based on the biblical description of heaven. And John 1 verse 3 was mentioned that it's being built for us, and it's waiting for us, and there's mansions and many houses over there, and this is how, by in the minds of the artist, that's how it looks like. And there's so many beautiful things there. One of the things they mentioned is gates made of pearls, and every several gates was a one whole barrel, you know, they're told them. And this deer, the street will be. The streets are lined with, it's made of pure gold. As it were transparent, so can you imagine how beautiful that is looking like? And according to the Bible, it was described, the foundation and the street will be adorned with 12 beautiful precious stones. I haven't seen any one of those in person. You don't use jewelry, but I don't have you seen any precious stones in your mind?
Probably not.
It's gonna be all over there. And then there's gonna be a tree that will bear fruit all throughout the year, so there will be no hunger. And the most important thing, the best part is, you'll be with God. You'll see him personally, and the most beautiful part is, he said that he will wipe away every tears from your eyes, from our eyes. There will be no death, no pain, no crying. How beautiful would that be, right? And extra bonus, according to the Bible, we will have an opportunity to travel space and see those things we see from here. We're just gazing up above. Now we will have an opportunity to see that as well. So the question is, probably I'm going to ask, how do we get there? Any ideas? How do we get there?
By an airplane?
Well, okay. Any other idea?
By praising God?
By
letting Him into our hearts.
That's what.
Any other ideas?
Giving our lives to Him.
Giving our lives to Him. Well, those are, what you said, are all very true. You know, if we believe that God or Jesus died for our sin and He rose again, but we will have opportunity to live an everlasting life. If we follow the commandments, if we follow His will, then we will have all the opportunity to stay on the city, but everlasting forever. And John 3 verse 16. You know this, right? Everybody knows this. Can you someone read for me? For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Isn't it that what you wanted? The beautiful Dubai will not be there forever, but this place will be there to eternity. So I hope you start imagining, and in your mind, this is going to be your goal for all of us to be there all together. Okay, we would like to pray a closing prayer. Who's going to pray? Jake.
Please bow your heads and close your eyes for prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you that you give us life. Let the people that are sick not be sick anymore. And thank you that we can enter you into our life. Amen.
Amen. Now you can go back to your seat quietly. Thank you.
Desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they may be saved. For merely being ignorant of God's righteousness and seeking to establish your own righteousness have not submitted to the righteousness of God. For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone who believes. So forever can we kneel down for prayer. Sanctuary. Thank you for this beautiful Sabbath morning and the gifts that Sabbath brings, the gift of physical rest and a moment to share with each other as we commune with you. We're so grateful for all the blessings that you're providing to each one of us. We come to you and ask you to sustain us with your love and grace. We pray for those who are not here today, for whatever reason. We especially pray for those amongst us who are faced with difficulties. Grant us with stillness that calms our mind and soul. Reassure us with love and protection that only you can provide. Fill our hearts with your presence, Lord, so we can experience the fullness of your love. We invite your holy presence as we continue to our service. Be with our speaker, Brother Ronald Obidas, and bless each one of us as we listen to the message. We ask you to be the center of our lives as we continue our journey in this demanding world until that glorious day that we meet face to face at the clouds of heaven. We ask all of this in your powerful name. Amen.
Amen.
But when he heard about the Seventh-day Adventist doctrines, his Adventist heart debated with his Jehovah's Witnesses heart, and his Jehovah's and his Adventist heart won the debate, and he was baptized in 1895. There are thousands and thousands of Asia, Europe, Australia, Canada, this man is from Canada, right? Yeah, he was an avid listener to his program.
No, not today. I've been watching him every day, almost every day, YouTube.
Among the, and he was, as a result of his being a pandemist, there was a young man, a very serious Pentecostal, listening to his program. Got interested, met him, and indoctrinated, and he was baptized. And among these listeners, there are people who wanted to support that young man. And now he is in Adventist Church, the ministerial ministerial course. And he was also a minister of the Iglesia de Cristo, 35 years, pastor of the Iglesia de Cristo. And he is one of those instruments in the conversion of that project in Sweden. Among Filipinos, seven Adventists, laymen in the Philippines, Ronald Guido is the best in research and defending the Seventh Adventist doctrine. He is our speaker, Brother Ronald Guido.
Amen. Thanks to the Lord. First of all, I would like to thank the Lord for having God with us. He provided a way and a means for me to come here to the church, and to Pastor Miguel Durante, who happened to be my longtime friend back then in the 90s. So I'm so glad and praising God, because right now I'm worshiping Him, and I'm going to spend my Sabbath worship along with in your church here. So praise the Lord, happy Sabbath, and good morning to you, everyone.
Good morning.
I also would like to thank the Rason brothers for their music that they offered to the Lord, and I'm sure that you like the song. And it's one of my favorite songs, you know. Since Pastor mentioned that I was a former Jehovah's Witnesses, I'm not used to hear a special song during my time as a Jehovah's Witnesses, because we only practice during our worship time, we only sing as a congregation about two times. During the first half-hour program, which is the Watchtower starting, you know, we're organizing Watchtower away, all right? Before we begin to study that lesson in that magazine, we are required to sing a congregational song. So I'm so glad and so blessed that now I'm Seventh-day Adventist. I'm so blessed. More because of the song that I heard every time I go to church. But until now, I'm still waiting for God's answer for my request. So I'm asking Him for something that I might learn how to sing. Anyway, thank you, Ben. I want to spend more time because we have a very short time left. My topic today is about, according to the which is written in the program, is the importance of evangelism. So you might ask, why do we need to hear that message again and again? Because as an Adventist, we already knew that the evangelism part of our mission as a church is very important, right? So I think I have to do something with this topic. Instead of just giving you lectures how to preach or how to give or to share the gospel, I would rather emphasize some factors or principles inherent in evangelism itself that has a big impact in my life. That's why I am now speaking to you as a Seventh-day Adventist, not as a Jehovah's Witnesses minister, right? And I hope and pray to the Lord that right after I discuss this very important sermon this morning, you might also apply it right away as soon as we finish our service today. So, I would like you to open up your Bible. You can have a Bible with you. All right? Let's open our book in the New Testament, in the book of Romans, chapter 10. This is where we are going to dwell in a whole sermon for this morning. Unfortunately, I forgot to give my PowerPoint presentation. Anyway, so if you are ready, I will read this passage in Romans chapter 10, verse 1 up to 5, based on the NIV Bible, or New International Version. It was written by the Apostle Paul, who is the foremost missionary during his time, not only as an apostle, not only as a defender of the gospel, but he is a foremost apostle, missionary, par excellence. According to Romans chapter 10, verse 1 to 5, brothers and sisters, my heart's desire and prayer to God for the Israelites is that they may be saved. For I can testify about them that they are zealous for God, but their zeal is not based on knowledge. Since they did not know the righteousness of God and sought to establish their own, they did not submit to God's righteousness. Verse 4, Christ is the culmination of the law, so there may be righteousness for everyone who believes. Verse 5, Moses writes this about the righteousness that is by the law. The person who does these things will live by them. So, first of all, we will notice that Paul's concern here is not about our culture, our nation, our country. His concern, his point, or his main concern is not about the Filipinos, the Americans, or any nationality. First and foremost, his main concern when it comes to evangelism is none other than what? Who? The Israelites. According to this passage, he is showing or expressing his concern, his heartfelt prayer, and his heartfelt pity on the nation of Israel. Why? Because in spite of the Israelites' religious practices, in spite of their zealousness in their faith, in fact, the modern Jews today are more zealous than some of the Seventh-day Adventist members, right? One time when I was in the Philippines, I tried to invite one Jewish rabbi to come over in our place, in our church, to give some lectures about their beliefs in the Messiah, in Jesus Christ. When I first spoke to this rabbi, his assistant to my invitation. You know why? Because he told me we are not supposed to proselyte, to do any proselytizing inside the church of a Gentile Christian. Because they thought that the Gentiles like us are not kosher or not clean. They consider us unclean. So even if they hear the term Christians, they are very much allergic to that term because they thought that they are the only chosen people of God, so they should not associate with us. But since when I told him that, don't worry, we are not a nominal Christians, we do not belong to the mainstream Christianity, we are unknown as a Seventh-day Adventist. And once he heard that Seventh-day Adventist, he positively replied to me and says, oh, Seventh-day Adventists, I know them very well. Seventh-day Adventists are like us, the Jews. We observe the Ten Commandments, especially the Sabbath, and they do observe the dietary laws. So, worry, don't worry. Okay, well, I will come over to your place, and we can associate with you. And then the right time came. This rabbi made the lecture. Is about the way to heaven, the way of salvation. So, in his conclusion, he mentioned that we, the
The Seventh-day Adventists, even though we are close to their teachings, even though we are close to their beliefs, we still can't make it to heaven. You know why? It's only because the Seventh-day Adventists, they used to take a bath during the Sabbath. While we as a youth, well, yeah, we have the convenience to take a bath. You know why? Because once we use soap in our body, as we wash our body during the bath, what will happen to the bar of soap? Once we finish our bath, we put it in the place where the soap is, then you will see the mark of your hands and your fingers over the soap. And that is a sign that you broke the Sabbath because you made a work in the Sabbath. So I told my brothers and sisters, please next time if you plan to take a bath during the Sabbath, use a different soap. But please, you will not see any mark of your fingers or hands using the soap, right? Now, and another thing in this Jew, particular Duke, says, the Seventh-day almost made it to heaven, the Seventh-day Adventist month. Unfortunately, aside from taking a bath during the Sabbath, which breaks the spirit of the Sabbath, for him, he told us also during that lecture that the Seventh-day Adventist people will not make it to heaven because the Seventh-day Adventist, they used to cook food during the Sabbath. So, since they belong to the, what we call the ultra-Orthodox Judaism, because Judaism right now has many factions or religions, and this particular rabbi belongs to the ultra-Orthodox Jews. So, for them, during the Sabbath, even Friday, which is the day of preparation, they used to shut off their electricity, even in their homes. They shut off their cell phone. They shut off their lights. So they are not allowed to use electricity during the Sabbath. Because for them, it is according to Exodus 35, verse 3, where God said, thou shalt not but leave a light during the Sabbath by fire. So if they use electricity, it is equivalent to lighting a fire during the Sabbath. So for this man, when I listen to him in his lecture, my mind is quite, you know, I am thinking about, well, if salvation, if the means of salvation is by keeping the law, I think these Jews will be the first to go to heaven, right? Yeah, so because they're more zealous. They're more zealous than us. So instead of, you know, they sacrifice their convenience and Sabbath, they shut off their electricity. They shut off everything that causes children. That's why they have a difficulty every Sabbath, especially when they are living in a building where the only means for them to go down and up their building is through the use of elevator. The problem is once they press the bottom of the elevator will produce light. So they cannot press the button for the elevator. So what they need to do, they have to wait for one of their neighbors who do not belong to their religion. They have to wait. They're willing to wait until the man comes and they will ask the man, please do me a favor. Please press this button for me. Because today, this Father will not suppose to light a leaf of fire or any electricity in the Sabbath. So their neighbor, the good neighbor, press the button for them, and then they can go inside the elevator and come down. Then the next problem is when they go inside the car, they have to start there. They cannot do the means to start the engine. The problem is, it is again considered as, you know, burning a fire. So they have to leave. They have also to wait for another person to help them. Jesus is the key for them. So this is just one example. Why? We understand Paul's statement that the Jews are so zealous with their faith. So, in this approach, we will notice if we go back to our scriptures that we read in Romans chapter 10, verse 1 to 5, Paul shows here that one of the elements or principle of evangelism is what? The first is the exposure of error, the expulsion of error. That is one principle of the past. That's why evangelism is still effective anytime, any place. Because in evangelism, we are not given the task only to tell the people what is the truth, but also we should tell them what is wrong with their version of truth. Amen? Sometimes we Adventists, we are so careful. By the way, there's nothing wrong with being careful of how to tell the truth, especially in telling the people where they are wrong. That is a very difficult task in evangelism, right? Because the natural person is, you know, sometimes because of our pride, our sinfulness, we are so close in our mind when somebody or someone will try to tell us that we are wrong in our belief. So, since that moment, since that time, since Paul as an apostle is appointed or was appointed to give the truth about the Lord Jesus Christ, he has to tell them the truth that they are, yes, they are sincere in their faith, but unfortunately, they are sincerely wrong. You know why they are sincerely wrong? The Apostle Paul presented to them that in order for them to go to heaven, all they need to accept is the Lordship of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And that is the only way. Remember John 26? Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through Him. First, does that say Jesus is just one of the way, or Jesus is just one of the truth, or Jesus is just one of the life? No. That is definitely article. So, another verse in Bible, in Acts 4:12, where it says, there is no other name under heaven that man can be saved, not other than the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. One time I encountered one pastor of a church denomination, evangelical church in my country, in Philippines. I heard him preaching in radio, over the radio, that the Seventh-day Adventist people are a cult. You know what the cult means? Whom are one of the scariest terms that a man or people can associate with the Adventists. So this man told me, I heard him preaching, the Seventh-day Adventists are a cult. You know why? Because, aside from the Bible, they have additional scriptures, which is not other than the writings of Ellen G. White. So, I think this person, I encountered him because we usually speak with the same radio station. I asked him, do you really understand the nature of the gift of prophecy in the Bible? He doesn't answer me directly. So what I did, I changed my question. I based my question based on Acts 4:12, where it says there is no other name under heaven that man should be saved. So I asked him, so, Pastor, if I'm going to answer this question, how do you answer? Let me give you an answer. My question is this. If I would like to become a member of your church, and then at the same time, I will only accept the name of Jesus Christ without accepting the founder of your religion, will I become a member of your church or not? You know, he directly told me, no, you cannot be a member. Aside from Jesus, you have to accept our leader as the man of God. So then I told him, you prepare the test. Acts 4:12 said, there is no other name under heaven which a man can be saved. But in your case, you are adding the name of your founder. So Jesus Christ the founder is not there in Acts 4:12. And then he asked me the same question. How about you look at this? You're an occult. You're an occult. But my uncle told him, you know, brother, you know, pastor, if you'd like to become a member of our church, we will only ask you to accept the name of the Lord Jesus. And you will be saved. Amen. Now this message in the Romans chapter 10 verse 9. Even if you do not recognize or even if you do not know about Adam White, you will be saved. Because that is what the person says, right? That's why in my family, when I speak this message, I started surprised that when I asked them to raise the hands of those Adventists who were long member of Adventists who doesn't understand or know about Adam White, none of them asked to raise their hands. You know why? Because for that, Jesus Christ is the Savior, never Ellen White. Ellen White is just a member, just a messenger sent by God, or what we call it, the Lord's messenger, who happens to have the special gift for prophecy. Now, let's go back to this verse. I want to emphasize something here. The same way we experience. Okay? I told you that the experience of Paul. I can relate to his experience. You know why? Because that Paul, in my case, I used to be an enemy of your church. I used to be one of the most opponents of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. As Pastor Peter Drake mentioned in his introduction, I used to be a debater. I used to be a debater, prosecutor, when I was a Jehovah's Witness. Have you heard about the Jehovah's Witnesses?
Yes.
When you hear about their name, what comes first in your mind?
Gold.
What else? That's a prison. What else? All right. All right. So the first thing that, you know, usually we know is that when we hear about Jehovah's Witnesses, what comes first in our mind is their zealousness for the word of witnessing, or the house-to-house witnessing, right? And, you know, as until today, I know that we can learn something, many things to them, especially their seriousness. How did they make it? What motivates them to show that such kind of seriousness, especially in our age? In many Filipino people, very much they noticed or saw Jehovah's Witnesses going down to their streets and decided to knock on their door. They would pretend that they were not there in their house. So when the Jehovah's Witnesses knock, hello, me, the Jehovah's Witnesses, we are right now visiting their place. Is there anyone there? One time, I encountered one person. No, nobody's here. And then one time, one child, when I knocked on the door, I saw a child, he went inside, these kids went inside. So I told him to come here. Can you please tell your mom that we are visiting here right now? So the kid went inside the house, and then after he went out, he told us, no, my mom told me he was not there. So that is just one of the few things that will challenge your temperance. Anyway, the good thing in evangelism is this, brothers and sisters. In my experience, 16 years, member of the Jehovah's Witnesses, 16 years, very seldom I encounter or experience divisions, gossips, war, or anger among the members. You know why? Because most of the Jehovah's Witnesses members are they can control their temper. They can control their temper. They are not easily angered. You know why? Because as they spend more time participating in evangelism and talk to many different people and countering many objections to their faith,
they can still manage to smile on the face. Even though, you know, because they are only human. Of course, we are human, but sometimes those objections can destroy our confidence. But you know, one thing that I would like, I would like to adopt here as a Seventh-day Adventist is their temperance. And like what I said, what helps them to control their temper is because they are used to participate in evangelism. Can you do that as well as church? Can you do that? Or maybe some of us will give an antibody, no, I can't, because I can't. I don't know if I control myself. Somebody banged his door in front of my face. Because we are all afraid of objection. Are we greater than the Son of God, Jesus Christ? Of course not. Jesus Christ encountered a lot of objections to the point that he was even insulted, he was even hit in the face, spit on his face, but still we hear the manage to open up his mouth and tell something. You see, there's a big help. There's a big help. Evangelism is a big help if you want to control your family. I remember one young man approached one pastor. This young man said, told his pastor, "Pastor, I have a weakness in my life. This is a hindrance towards my spiritual growth. Please pray for me, Pastor." So the pastor asked this kid, "So what do you want me to pray to you?" So this young man said, "Please, Pastor, pray for me that, you know, God would give me more patience." Yeah. So when the pastor prayed for him, "All right, Heavenly Father, this young man is requesting for patience. So as an answer to that prayer, Heavenly Father, please give him more problems. Give him more trials. Give him more objections." And then this young man, they said, "Please, Pastor, no, it's not what I'm asking for. What I'm asking for is just give me patience." So, Pastor, you give the wrong prayer to God. So the pastor explained to this young man, "How can you practice patience if you do not encounter trials and problems, difficulties in your life?" So trials, difficulties, they are actually a blessing in disguise. Would you agree with that? Okay, now, let's go back to the text. Now, brothers and sisters, like Paul, I have also a desire in my heart, and I always pray that my former brethren, the Jehovah's Witnesses, would come soon to know about the Lord Jesus Christ. That's the only thing. You know the secret why the Jehovah's Witnesses are so zealous in their faith? Are you interested to know about their secret? How come they are so zealous in witnessing that we sometimes are missing? Do you want to know the secret, brothers and sisters? Are you sure about it?
Yeah.
Are you serious? If I tell you the secret, brothers and sisters, will you do the same?
You should.
I know just a very few answered that question. You know the secret, brothers and sisters? Since I was well aware, as a Jehovah's Witness, in 16 years, their secret is what? Because the secret is their salvation is at one. So it means that they believe that in salvation by works. Salvation by works. So for them, salvation is not it. Salvation is a reward. So they have to do more things, spend more time doing evangelism, because for them, that is the only requirement and the only way for them to inherit the kingdom of God. Try this test, brothers and sisters. One time, if a Jehovah's Witness happens to knock on your door, try to let them in and ask them this question. Are you a child of God at this moment?
You know what will they answer? They will tell me, no, not yet. We, the Jehovah's Witnesses, are not yet considered to be a child of God. That's why we are doing this thing, this evangelism. We must be zealous in witnessing, because without this, we will not consider to be the child of God in the near future. So for them, the reason why they are so zealous, the reason why they are so eager to witness to household preaching, because they are not yet child of God. Do you realize what does it mean? In the Bible, in Romans chapter 8, verse 15, Paul said, it is only the child of God, all the sons of God, who are given the Holy Spirit. Right? If you are the child of God, therefore you have to give up the Holy Spirit. The opposite is, if you are not the child of God, therefore you don't have the Holy Spirit, right? Now, the Jehovah's Witnesses are not yet child of God. Therefore, they don't have yet the gift of the Holy Spirit. And in Corinthians, Paul says that the Holy Spirit was given to each and every one of us when we accept Jesus Christ as Lord and as Savior. He gave us the free gift of the Holy Spirit as a deposit, down payment, in order to assure our inheritance in the kingdom of God. You say anything to that? The Holy Spirit is a down payment. It's an advance payment from heaven. So even before we reach after heaven, we can experience how heaven is like while we are here on the earth because of the power of the Holy Spirit. But really, you know, what is speaking with our brethren in my former religion, they are not yet child of God. They do not have the Holy Spirit, so therefore they do not have the assurance of heaven. What else? They do not have the Spirit. They are not yet the child of God. They do not yet have the Spirit, the assurance of kingdom of God. But they are zealous. Right? They are so eager to share their faith in spite of these three things which is missing in them. They don't have the Spirit. They don't have, they are not yet the child of God. And they do not have an assurance in heaven. But they are zealous. Now the challenge with us, Seventh-day Adventist people here, is this. Do you consider yourself today as a child of God? If you are a child of God, do you have the gift of the Holy Spirit? Do you have the gift operating in your life? Yes. So therefore, if you have the Holy Spirit, the down payment from heaven, then you have an inheritance. You are assured of your inheritance in the kingdom of God. You say anything to that? But what happened? If you compare this Jehovah's Witnesses, not child of God, no Holy Spirit, no assurance, and with this child of God, with the Spirit, with assurance, the witnesses are zealous, and how about the evidence? What happened? Do you realize what I'm saying here? This is a challenge for us. Because if there is some religious organization which should think well known around the world to be more zealous in their faith, to be more zealous in going from house to house, it should be another reason. Right? You know why? Because we already received Jesus Christ, and because of that, we have the right. We are now a child of God. We have now received the Holy Spirit. And we have the assurance in heaven. But how come? We are missing that life. We are missing that zealousness that the Jehovah's Witnesses have. But the Jehovah's Witnesses, not yet children of God, no Holy Spirit, no assurance in heaven, but zealous. I hope you will think about it, brothers and sisters. Alright. Then, let's go to the second point. So, in evangelism, there's an exposure from error. You know, in my experience, Until now, it is not sinking on my mind that I will become a Seventh-day Adventist, that we're not speaking here. Because my family, my mother, father, and all my siblings are still members of Jehovah's Witnesses. When I came here to the United States, I stayed in their place. It's very difficult. Because once you are disgruntled to the Jehovah's Witnesses, you are not considered to be part of their family. As if they are not your family. They will not speak to you about the Bible. They will not provide food for you. They will not even greet you, even your close friends. Even my relatives, they do not even greet me. They treat me as if I have a leprosy. They do not even my brother right now. He's not excited to see me. But he can avoid to watch me because he's my friend on Facebook. When I upload all my evangelism, my evangelistic activities, he can avoid that sin. Now, the challenge here, brothers and sisters, is this. I cannot speak to them about the Bible. If I talk to them about Jesus, they will run away. But if we talk about business, family life, that will be okay with them. But they are not allowed to speak to me about the Bible. That is my main problem. Before, when I came to America, my only challenge is how can I talk to them? But now, you know why, brothers and sisters? My presence here in America is an answered prayer. You know why? Because I pray to God that, Lord, my parents, actually my mother died already, but you know, in her deathbed, in the hospital, when my brothers and sisters gave me an opportunity to speak to my mother, I introduced him to Jesus Christ. I introduced him to Jesus Christ. During when she was in the comatose, but she can, I know that she can hear me. She's responding. I prayed with her, even against with my brothers and sisters are here. I tell my mom, you know, mom, this is the moment. Today, the Watchtower Society, the Jehovah's Witness cannot help you. Your religion cannot do anything to save you from your situation. All you need to do, mom, is the Lord Jesus Christ. Mom, please, before you die, please accept Jesus Christ. He is the way. He is the truth. He is the life. Not the religion. You need to accept Jesus Christ as your personal Lord. I said, well, you know what happened? My mom responded when he gave me his prayer. You know, at that moment, when a certain person dies, he will forget what he has. His properties, his bank account, he will forget. But he is only interested in the thing is about his future eternity.
Amen.
Amen. So at the end of this sermon, brothers and sisters, I would like you to, I hope you will be encouraged. First of all, because number one, I hope and I pray that you get encouraged to be positive in your mind about doing the work of God, which is sharing the gospel.
Amen.
Do not be disappointed if somebody or someone whom you approach has rejected you. Remember, it is not you whom they reject, it is the Lord Jesus Christ. Number two, remember that God gave you the Holy Spirit, that you are now child. You were once a sinner, you were once an unbeliever, heading for hell, but because somebody shared to you the gospel, so right now, you are welcome to the kingdom of God. And number three, remember always
that, you know, winning argument is not our purpose, our agenda. It is winning to the soul and bring that in to Jesus Christ. Because without Christ, nothing else can save us. Happy Sabbath. The love of the Holy Spirit be with us today and forever. In Jesus' name.